Good morning, everybody. How was the party last night? Was it good? Oh my God, it must have been good. You're tired. Hey, wake up. We've got a good opening keynote, a good opening summit for you now with the visions of leaders. And as you can see here, the title is The Evolution of Marketing Services. Now, obviously, we are all using marketing services in order to make our marketing successful. And many of us have probably seen all of these four executives or using their product in the last probably 5 to 10 years. They've all become quite famous, and without these tools, you're probably not as successful as you want to be. And we have a great keynote speaker and also the moderator. He's been here yesterday. I had to get him off stage. He was so good. Everybody wanted to listen to him, but obviously he has got some more speaking time today. So please welcome our intro keynote speaker and moderator for the next panel. And come on, please make some noise for the CEO and founder of MediaLink, Mr. Michael Kassan.
Thank you very much. I promise I won't finish the remarks from yesterday. I'll start fresh this morning, but just wanna welcome everybody and thank you for taking the time this morning. We're talking about evolution. Not biological evolution, but a marketing services evolution in which we must constantly anticipate, reorient, and then act in a highly complex and daunting ecosystem. This type of evolution is a story we can all relate to, and it doesn't take place over generations. It happens every day at a speed that, at least for now, is at a human pace, which makes us all characters in this interesting story. And this story is an epic, sweeping adventure. It's big, with big themes and big action, big stakes, big consequences, and of course, big data. As marketers, communicators, consultants, technologists, and media industry executives, we are tasked with charting a profitable and yet accountable course through a vast and often bewildering environment in which the Huffington Post publishes a story every 58 seconds. In this digitally enabled world, marketing services is impacted by two overarching dynamics: constant change and ever-deepening connections. One, and usually both of these, sometimes antagonistic, sometimes symbiotic forces, are behind every problem we face and every opportunity that opens before us. In our campaigns, our organizations, and outlooks, and combined, they put unprecedented pressure on every point in the marketing value chain. This evolution has turned digital from a strategy to a tool, and it's given birth to an entirely new area of ad technology. It's kind of made us all content creators. It has elevated the importance and dramatically altered the skill set of chief marketing officers, who shortly, it is estimated, will command more IT dollars than the chief information officers. And it is this evolution that brought together, I think, two marketing services powerhouses, the holding companies of Publicis and Omnicom. As DigiDay, a US-based publication, observed, the agency business needs to disrupt itself massively and move beyond simply making and placing ads. Agencies must become experts at content, real-time storytelling, technology, social engagement, and multi-voice conversation. In addition, there is a movement of integration on every side of the technology equation. As Aaron Levy recently tweeted about the new Android OS KitKat, the hardware players are moving into software, the software players are moving into hardware, and Google seems to be moving into candy. On every side of the marketing equation, as brands strive to perfect a platform-agnostic, data-enlightened, customer-focused integrated strategy. Alas, all those buzzwords are much easier said than done. So today, we have gathered a group of very innovative players in this epic story, executives who spend every day thinking about and acting on the evolution of digital marketing services. I'd like to introduce our panel this morning at this point. Bob Lord, CEO, AOL Networks. Kevin Bishop, VP and General Manager, IBM. John Mellor, VP Strategy and Business Development from Adobe, and Chris Schaumann, VP Digital Marketing CRM from Nokia. Guys, thank you. Okay, Chris, we established that we pronounce your name Schaumann, so I thought I was the Schaumann, but I'm counting on you. So,
thank you.
Any song and dance will be well accepted. The first one, Chris, will be for you. It's the question I'm not allowed to ask you. So your card says Nokia on it now. Will it say that for long, or will it have a different end to it? Something with an M? I'm not sure. I read something about that.
There might be something in the works. There was recently quite an announcement, I have to say, and I'm personally super excited because I actually used to work for Microsoft before.
Well, now you do again, or almost, so welcome back. Redmond has changed.
I'm sure it has. I hope so.
So, guys, what I wanted to do is I wanted to sort of frame our conversation, and this is a jump ball question that I will throw out to the group of you. And it's got some subparts to it. So let me just start with the original question, because I modified it a little earlier this morning. I framed it originally in the context of challenges, and what I wanted to ask is, what is the most critical challenge facing the marketing services industry from your perspective? And at the same time, what's the most interesting or enticing opportunity? The subset to that question will be, how would you have answered that question differently 12 months ago if you were on the stage at DMEXCO and kind of peering around the corner as a subset? How would you answer that question a year from now if you were invited back? And again, depending on how we do this morning, maybe you will be. Kevin, could I throw that your way as a kickoff?
For sure. So the biggest challenge and the biggest opportunity is us, each one of us in this room and each one of us in the street outside, consumers as individuals. This whole phenomenon, this social phenomenon, whether it's using Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, about each of us taking our control of our own identity, is causing something around individuation and me, which has not been present in society before. So our challenge in marketing services is to help our clients that are marketing to the consumer treat everybody as an individual. It's all about me. I don't care about your product. I care about how it's useful to me, how I use it in my life, how it enhances my experience, and if it detracts from my experience, I am going to tell everybody about it. So getting things to the point where it's all about me, the individual, and doing that with scale. Because there's quite a lot of us in this room, but there's hundreds of millions of us outside who all wanted to be treated as an individual. That's the biggest challenge, and that creates a huge opportunity.
So Kevin, how would you have answered that question a year ago?
Well, a year ago it would have been the same answer, but it would have been all about marketing, and we're in a marketing conference. But today it isn't about marketing. It's about continuous customer engagement. Because it's about how I choose between things, how I acquire things, how I use those things, how I share my experience of using those things. It's a whole cycle of engagement that we need to be engaged with. And that takes us outside of our responsibility as marketeers into the domain of the whole company. And how do I collaborate with my colleague who runs service management? How do I collaborate with my colleague in sales? So that every single touch point with me is adding value. That's very different from a year ago.
I'm going to come back to the question about a year from now. Bob, over to you. You've recently gone through a bit of a revolution for yourself. You went from running Razorfish on a global basis and Digitas in the Publicis world to running the AOL networks. And, you know, we talked earlier about the pivot, yeah. The pivot between a buyer and a seller. You know, as I said, I think historically sellers lean in, buyers lean back. You've just made a pivot. How's it going? And also, you know, to the question I asked about kind of the challenges.
Yeah, no. You know what? I think the challenge is we're coming at this problem from two very different vantage points, whether you want to say lean in, lean out, whether you're a technologist or whether you're a marketer. And what the challenge that we all face, we faced it last year, we'll face it this year, and actually it'll only be more important next year, is to put the olive branch out to learn each other's craft. And don't discount each other's craft. So marketing organization is going to bring us lots of brand knowledge into the technology space. And the technology space is going to bring a lot more rigor into sort of the brand science. And right now what I find is there's a lot of people who turn things off. So if you're talking to a marketer and you say API, they have no idea what the next word is out of your mouth. Okay, so you sort of have to say, okay, let me put myself in their shoes and how would I explain what an API is from a marketing perspective? And then when you're talking to a technologist and you start talking about brand purpose and human experience, the technologist starts to turn off because they don't understand why is that important, because I'm going to deliver a product and I don't need to know about brand purpose. So the challenge we've got as an industry right now is understanding how one can actually help the other and together come to the place for a solution. So it's this idea of convergence that's really, I think, the major challenge. And I see it starkly as I come from Razorfish on more or less the brand side, going over into the tech world, because the languages are so different that I find myself trying to have to bridge the two together.
Well, and you know, John, coming over to you with your Adobe hat on, which you know, puts you in a category, in a couple of categories, but certainly Adobe is at the same table with Oracle and Salesforce and some of the other folks that are focusing on cloud computing and all the things that are happening in the marketing cloud, if you will. And you know, that's a word that has probably association with one brand or another, but it has an overarching opportunity. And as we talk about the mashup in this evolution of CIO, CTO, CMO, how are you addressing that? And again, same question about the challenge, you know, facing you.
So, you know, I think the real challenge is one of silos. I mean, we've certainly seen this evolve. You know, and let's just think about our own careers. We probably all grew up in this business with some sort of specialty over the last few years, whether it was search or display or video or whatever it was. And what we're seeing today is that we need, in order to effectively have a dialogue and a relationship with consumers, we have to break down those silos. And there's a technology element to that, meaning companies like Adobe have to break down the abilities for the email team to talk to the display team, to talk to the social team, and have the data be able to be shared between all of those channels. But then there's, and that's probably the challenge that I would have said really faced Adobe a year ago. You know, now I think going forward, the silo challenge is really an organizational challenge. As we move deeper and deeper into digital marketing becoming just marketing, we see that the organizational structures in companies oftentimes have to change. We have to change you know, who reports to whom, how people are incented, and that's an organizational shift that's going to take time. And I think companies like Adobe can really help drive that from a technology standpoint with just user interface design, workflow design, things that make it more intuitive for the email team to talk to the social team, to talk to the display team. I'll say that, you know, Adobe's heritage is certainly a creative heritage and a marketing heritage. And our view is you have to do all of that with the aim of telling a story. We have to keep the story, the creative alive. Because at the end of the day, as consumers, we want great creative, and we don't have relationships with channels. We have relationships with brands. And tell me a story, engage with me, but use the technologies as the paintbrush, maybe, to paint that story.
As we talk about paintbrushes, Chris, and I say this in the most positive sense, I remember the day not that long ago when the coolest, hippest phone I went after was the Nokia. I remember that silver, shiny little slide phone. See, there you go. Good product placement. And you know, famously and maybe not so famously, there's been some challenges in terms of the marketplace and whatnot with Nokia, and yet you're poised on the back of the most recent announcement to have another chance at a first impression, I think, in the hardware marketplace. How do you look at that? Again, this is not about the deal or anything you can't talk about. This is just in terms of looking at the evolution you're about to go through, or maybe in your case, a revolution you're about to go through.
Well, I think the story of Nokia's transformation has started some time ago, and I think the challenge that we're facing and that we're tackling, and I think we found a solution for it, is not necessarily the awareness of the brand or sometimes the awareness of our products, but really giving the consumers the opportunity to try it out, the consideration. What we've put in place is basically a global measurement framework around four distinct consumer outcomes. And the first one is the learn more phase, where people are starting to explore what kind of choices there are, what kind of brands, what functionalities there are. We've then analyzed in the digital platforms what kind of engagements in our owned and also in our earned and our and also offsite media, what kind of engagements are actually increasing consideration, product consideration the most. And those engagements we have then defined as KPIs for most of our bought media advertising and marketing to really drive down the consumer and optimize the user journeys against those outcomes. And that obviously increases then consideration, and once we have the products in the hands of the consumers or bring them to life in digital storytelling, then we're pretty confident that these innovative products are now delivering more and more on the consideration uplift.
So Bob, what does the new data suite look like? I mean, you know, there's all this talk, big data. My partner, Wendell Millard, loves to say, what happened to little data? Did we forget about little data? We're all talking about big data. But what does the data suite look like? And you've got an interesting perspective right now. And, you know, in a sort of offline, online consumer engagement.
Yeah, no, so and I, you know, sometimes we and I've heard we talk about big data in ways that we shouldn't be talking about it. And I think the first thing we have to go back to is what is the damn consumer journey and what's the consumer life cycle, whether they're in a purchase funnel or whether they're a consumer that we want to retarget, whatever that may be. When you start to understand the consumer journey, then you can start to apply understand patterns around data, and you can understand behaviors. And then once we start to understand the patterns and behaviors, which, you know, the synonymous thing when you talk about big data, you have to talk about cloud computing. The only reason why we're actually talking about big data is because actually we can crunch things in volumes that we've never been able to do before. That gives us insights, which allows us to get to patterns, which then allows us to do great marketing around the consumer journey. But if you don't start, you don't go back up to what's the journey that the consumer is going through, then big data and the concept of big data gets lost. And you're spending a ton of money crunching lots of things, but you actually don't know what you're crunching them for because you're looking for something out of that big data that you may not have. So if it's not based in sort of the journey itself to understand patterns of recognition and implications and then target your marketing, then we get lost. And I think that's the problem. We're not solving a big data problem. We're solving a customer journey issue.
Well, on that customer journey, and again, for you, Bob, or for anyone on the couch, is there a balance here between sort of the, you know, analyzing the data and the algorithm, you know, kind of the human role in this? And I'll give you a case in point. When YouTube was launching their premium channels to a lot of fanfare last year, and you know, all the noise around that, there was an internal debate that was going on, which I found very interesting, because they were of the mind in San Bruno that it wasn't necessary to promote these premium channels, but rather rely on the algorithm to drive viewership. Because in the classic YouTube sense, that's how it was done, and they weren't going to use the front page to promote the new shows on the premium channels. And coming from the background that I did from the entertainment side of the world before the media business, I said, you know, there's something to be said for wrapping a bus occasionally and taking a billboard in Times Square or, you know, on the Sunset Strip. I apologize for the U.S. focus of that, but in Piccadilly or in any other main, you know, thoroughfare, that versus just relying on the algorithm. How is that playing out in real time? I mean, you have the issue at AOL. You've got great premium programming. How are you driving that viewership? And
yeah, no. I think it is. I think this is what we started out with, right? We have people fundamentally technology that are born in technology that believe that because they have a good product and the product is going to prevail, that they don't have to do marketing. And one cannot live without the other. And this is bridging the gap. So your YouTube story is very, very pertinent to that. I believe that there's a mix here. There has to be a mix. You have to use media tools, traditional media tools, to drive audiences, understand what the consumer journey is, and then use the product and the data to target.
Thank God, because there's a lot of naked buses running around the world now with no wrappings on them. I don't know what to do. John or Kevin, go ahead.
Yeah, so I'd like to tell a story that links to this. So, you know, I'm from IBM, so obviously my whole career is about data and facts and data-driven decision-making and so forth. But everything we do has to be rooted in people and people behavior. And one of the most compelling stories that I retell frequently came from one of our clients in the hotel trade, who's very clear, you need to understand what problem you're trying to solve. So if you're in a hotel business and you're trying to get somebody to spend as many of their nights in your hotel as possible over their lifetime and their family's lifetime, the kind of insights you need to know about them, you know, lead you down one set of data. But if you're looking at a hotel tonight, and how do I maximize consumption in the spa, in the restaurant, and so forth, it's a completely different set of information you need. Because the journey the client's on to enjoy their stay, and the way they're going to respond to the handwritten note from the manager under the door, saying if you'd like to bring your partner down to the spa, we'll do two for the price of one today. Or going to respond to the SMS that says, there's a free bottle of wine in the restaurant this evening if you dine. That journey is such a different journey to why you will go back to the same property.
What they might say is, and if you don't have a partner, we'll help find you. No, that's a different service. Probably shouldn't go there. It's too early in the morning.
So data's great, but you've got to be rooted in the human journey and what insights you have about people's behavior that data can then help you with.
You know, we talk about an analogy, just the other side of Adobe. There is absolutely a place for algorithms. The amount of data that we're dealing with today is just, it's impossible to deal with without real machines and algorithms doing a lot of the work. But, in the same way that Photoshop is a wonderful, powerful tool, you're never gonna take the human out of the process of real artistic output. And I think, it's easy to overlook or discount maybe the human element in the marketing process now that there's so much technology, but that's a shame. That's not the right approach. And it's probably a pendulum swing, and we'll find that right balance. But the power of storytelling and the power of creative is will take the day ultimately.
So Kevin, I want to come back to you for a second. We chatted yesterday, and I found it so interesting. I was reading an article the other day, and it gave a great shout out to IBM, and it's what we talked about yesterday over coffee. And the point was, let me give you the backdrop. I've always been interested in that analogy that people use about the railroad industry. If the railroads were in the transportation business, they would have been owning the airlines. Instead, they were in the railroad business. That sort of, somebody who's been a success in one era generally doesn't transcend to other eras. And here's IBM, and they were pointed out in this article talking about another company in transition at some sort of similar size, and IBM has done an extraordinary job of going from a company that in my lifetime I thought of both in the hardware and software sense, going back to Mag cards, and I'm old so I remember that stuff, and today you're so not in that business, you're in another business and wildly successful at that. Love to have a little bit of that evolution story if you would share it.
So it's not a complicated story, because it's about having clarity about what your purpose is, why you exist in the world. And we're not a technology company. We're a company that's about making a difference in people's lives. So we're in the business of helping our customers help their customers. So we help the hospitals cure cancer. We help retailers get better sales. And all the while you're framing your business about how do you bring innovation and apply it in a meaningful way, so that what we do with our client helps their client, the citizen, the shopper, the saver, the borrower, the pupil. You keep focused on what matters. And it's that constant ability to be focused on the future and the value that you're going to bring that has allowed us to reinvent the business model and the technologies we work with. And it is the business model, not just the technologies. We've been in hardware, we've been in software, we've been in services. We've sold things as capital goods. We sell them now as services. It's constantly evolving to where the market is in the future. The ability to adapt always around a meaningful purpose is what served us really well in the past. And I'm very confident that's why it keeps serving us well going forward.
Well, and the thing you pointed out yesterday, and I think it's so important, IBM is a company, and you made this point, that was not formed and built in the shadow of an individual. I mean, I'm certain if we took a poll, people could name some of the CEOs of IBM, but it wouldn't be as readily available to them as, say, an Oracle or a Microsoft or obviously an Apple, where there was a person that defined a culture or, a few people, whereas at IBM, it that's not the case.
We're a community of currently 435,000 individuals that share a common ideal, share some common values and some common behaviors about innovation that matters because you apply it, about working with clients for their benefit, dedication to their success, and about trust, and about how you work with each other as a collegiate community. It's not a cult of the individual, and that, again, I think really helps us constantly to adapt, not just to changing times, but to changing markets.
Absolutely.
To be as relevant in Shanghai as we hopefully are here in Cologne, as we would be back in the US.
Great, thank you. Chris, 2013, is this finally the year of mobile? or the moment of mobile, we've had a couple of those I would characterize as false starts in terms of the year of mobile. Is this it? Are we there?
I think we're still not there, and I think we should continue to call each year the year of the mobile until we really
just in honor of Chris Schaumann. That's it.
I would be honored, but I think we're still lagging behind the consumer. If you think about probably by the end of this year, analysts are predicting that more people will log onto the internet with anything but a PC, meaning tablets and smartphone and even mobile phones. And we still haven't really captured that opportunity yet. And I think the challenge around that is not necessarily the fault of the mobile medium or the channel or the players in that channel. I think the fault lies with us. I think we're constantly kind of catching up with the consumer. And I think one of the biggest challenges our industry is facing is change and the acceleration and the pace of change that's actually accelerating. And coping with that and really being agile and having the capability and the talent to harness that change and these new opportunities is probably one of the biggest challenges that faces the mobile medium per se. For us at Nokia, we've embraced mobile marketing obviously for a long time now. And from an ROI perspective, I think it's one of the best delivering channel of all media channels. And the reason for that, again, is probably threefold. One is the typical demand and supply. There's an oversupply, which brings down the pricing. Secondly, it's quite an exclusive environment if you think about the experience you have on your mobile phone. But also the use case of a user, you're often in a situation where you probably have some time at your hand on the commute or in a downtime where you can actually explore and deviate from your initial tasks and be a little bit more open to explore, let's say, an advertising message or a certain experience that an advertiser is trying to deliver to you. And then ultimately, it's a very intimate device. The use case is very intimate, and you have almost an exclusive experience opportunity to create with the consumer in a mobile device. So I think it's going to continue to be a focus area for many, many marketers, and for us, it's absolutely a priority. We actually have just finished a global rollout of our websites, about 80-plus websites around the world, all on HTML5 and built on responsive, basically getting rid of our mobile site and having not just a PC and a mobile site, but a common platform that scales and leverages the opportunity of each of the devices based on certain screen breakpoints. And I believe that rollout of over 80 websites around the world is one of the biggest HTML5 responsive site rollout in the world. And if you may, just go to any of our Nokia websites and just on a PC version, just scale the browser window back and forth, and you can see how the columns, the layout, the image quality scales depending on your browser size and ultimately the screen size of the device. And I think there lies also the opportunity to kind of harness this kind of ever-increasing fragmentation of the ecosystem, kind of bring it back together into one platform to really optimize that user journey no matter what screen the user's accessing.
So I think you've just solved the age-old problem, size matters, I guess, right? John, I think you were going to say something.
Yeah, I think that it's a
I hope you're going to say
fantastic
something.
Fantastic point, because the Nokia side is a great example of this. There are probably a couple of adjectives that in 5 years we won't be using, and one is mobile. You know, because what is mobile? You look here on the front row and you've got people on phones, on tablets, on laptops. How do you define mobile? And the Nokia site being developed how it is it's more a situation where you're trying to infer as marketers the context of the situation, and that may be a function of the screen size more so than calling something mobile. It may be a function of, is that device moving or is it stationary? Has it been stationary for a long period of time? So those are the factors that I think, as we abstract out from things like mobile advertising or even digital marketing, as we abstract out, we'll start to think in terms of that consumer.
Absolutely. I don't want to, although we could have a contest for naming rights, but digital marketing is I think a similar word that's going to disappear at some point. It would be marketing. And people say, well, digital, show me something that's not digital. In fact, I want to let you all in on a secret. This is a hologram. We're actually not here. So This is digital at its best. Bob's in Cleveland right now, but Bob, as you've made this switch, and we chatted about this last night, you've been able to kind of take the gloves off in a different way. You were on the, as we said, on the agency side for so long and advising clients from that perspective, and now you're, you know, coming in from through a different door. Has it taken the gloves off, really? Can you have a different opinion now? I guess you have to, but how does that dialogue work out? Are you feeling better about your ability to communicate strategic ideas from this perch or from your previous perch?
Yeah, no, I think what I can do now, and I think I did it as an agency partner also, but we can really focus on the economics of the inefficiency within the marketing system. And I think I can speak very frankly about how do we actually, when you spend a dollar, how is that dollar maximized through the chain, the value chain? And ultimately, what we're all trying to do in the technology community is allow that to be really, really efficiently done. So all of the mundane tasks that we do with matching and finding audiences and finding suppliers, make that really, really efficient and make it's super, super cheap to do. Because then what that allows us to do is to actually explode creativity and actually give more money to our agencies, give more money back to the brand owners. Because when you start talking about mobile advertising or mobility and advertising, you actually start talking about a very different kind of unit. You talk about a utility unit, an interactive unit. And that takes a lot more creativity than it ever has in the past. So from my vantage point of sort of where I've been and where I'm going, what I see my job to be is to maximize and make that dollar that someone's finding an audience and where the placement's going, make that really efficient so I can give more money back to the agencies and back to the brand marketers so that they can actually explode on creativity. And that's sort of, it's an interesting vantage point to be at because, you know, you, as an agency person, you're complaining, oh my God, why am I spending so much money on this? Why am I, now I'm on the other side saying, okay, you don't have to spend so much money on it, let me try to fix it for you. So it's actually, you know, and it's a fun switch to go back and forth on. That's why I think the challenge is us understanding each other's language to solve this problem together.
Well, so I'd like to add a point about creativity, because whilst I completely agree creativity is central to this, I think the nature of it is changing. It isn't about whether I can create a better ad. It's about whether I can create a better moment through the utility of what is on that mobile device in context. Because it might be that what I want is not an ad, it's an offer. It might be that what I want is a contact. It might be that what I want is some information. And understanding the right connection between how to use paid and owned content, that requires deep creativity, understanding the customer's journey, and then serving up the thing that is of the most value. And I think all the while the paradigm is around the notion of shifting an ad to a mobile, it's the wrong paradigm. It's about shifting value to a mobile device. And what is the nature of that value has to be rooted in understanding the client.
And is the consumer ready for it? Is the consumer ready for, anecdotally, I'll share a story. I was having lunch with someone in Los Angeles a couple of months ago in the Century City Westfield Mall, and there's an Apple store there in the mall, and he was coming to meet me for lunch, and I was walking towards the restaurant, and he was walking the other way, and I thought, okay. He said, you know, I'll meet you in 2 minutes. He said, I have to run and buy something for my child. Okay, well, I'm not going to say no to that. And he expressed to me the reason he did that. He had received one of those messages from Apple saying, you have an Apple store credit, because he was in the vicinity. He didn't go to Apple, but it reminded him that his, you know, young daughter had seen a case for her iPhone at a little kiosk stand, and that made him think about it. So whilst Apple was trying to drive him into the Apple store, he actually was driven to make a purchase. But, you know, that was brilliant. He certainly wasn't bothered by the intrusion. It was something that was productive for him and positive for him. You know, I throw the question to any of you. Is the consumer really ready for that? And how will they react to it in the long term?
I think the consumer would be more than ready to that if we use the paradigm that Kevin mentioned, that we think about this as a value exchange. And I think that's probably...
Because this guy got value out of it, clearly. Yep. He was thrilled because it reminded him that he forgot to buy this thing for his daughter, so he was a happy dad.
not quite the value the sender probably intended, but certainly a value for the end user. And I think that's one of the new paradigms in marketing is to look marketing as value-based marketing. What kind of experiences or content or service can we deliver to our end users that enlighten them, that entertain them, that add a value to their daily lives, instead of just having advertising messages or product messages? And I think here lies the opportunity of the medium to really expand that and deliver amazing, immersive, interactive experiences around that, and ultimately great content. And I think content is going to be playing an ever-increasing important part in the marketing mix, and that's one of the big challenges as well. How do the clients, the client organization, the agencies, and also the media owner deal with content, and how do they produce, disseminate, and optimize excellent content that provides value to the user?
One of the words that we probably should eliminate, what we were talking about before, is advertising. Just
completely
strike
agree.
The word.
Completely
Get
agree.
Rid of advertising.
I think we're just going to start numbering things. We're just going to say 37 because we can't. So we just have to ascribe numerical value to everything now because we can't say digital, mobile, or advertising. What the hell are we doing here? I'm confused.
It's such a powerful point because it comes back to that experience. There's a pharmacy that I use at home, and they just launched an app where I can now go to refill my prescription and just open the app, scan the barcode on my pill bottle, and it asks me when I want to pick it up, and I can pick it up, and it's fantastic. Now, is that advertising? I don't think so, but it's somehow falling under the umbrella of the marketer's domain, because it's technology that's evolving on our watch under our umbrella, and therefore we carry some responsibility for it. I mean, think about the bank who you put your card into the ATM machine, you're denied. You get your card back out. Well, if the bank believes that you have you're a high value customer, they probably want to capture that. Maybe send a note to the call center, have the call center give you a call, or send a push message to your mobile phone. That starts to be an experience that adds value to the consumer, and it's going to very likely fall under the marketer's umbrella as their responsibility, because it boils up to the consumer experience.
No, I think this important concept of taking your brand as a service is a really, really important thing for marketers to understand. So people have heard me say this before, but it's probably the best example out there because, Michael, they've been doing it for years, is we don't think about Nike as selling sneakers. We think about Nike as an athletic company. And the reason why we think about Nike as an athletic company is because they have surrounded their product with technology devices and services that are value to me. So what John's just mentioned, whatever that drugstore is, they now have provided him with a service more than just a brand promise. And I think when we use technologies that way, you actually get away from advertising, and you get away from, I am helping, technology is helping a consumer in a way that it hasn't done that before. And that puts a lot of onus on the creative agencies to do their job in a very, very different way than they've ever had before.
So there are two things I want to, Kevin, did you have something?
Well, I just wanted to reinforce
no,
both
please.
Of those. I wanted to reinforce both of those
could
stories.
Could you disagree so we could duke it out
disagree.
A little?
With a... Timeliness matters. It's kind of the same point I made before. Because if you're the banking example, so another bank, one of our clients, has a little application. So you leave your money in the cash point machine. You take your card, you forget to take the money, you walk away. So in the moment, they know that. They suck the money back in, and they do an SMS message to tell you, you left your money, it's okay, we took it back in, it's not been debited from your account. That's value. But that's a marketing moment. It's using SMS real-time targeting, but it's doing it in a way that is highly value-add. And the Nike example, and that's different, because that's about getting fit over time. So the whole thing they do with the Spark program and the training of the athletics teachers in schools and things, that's about a long-term relationship. So it's all about permission in the end. Not do I have opt-in permission to receive an email, but do you have brand permission because you matter to me in an objective that I have to get well, to get my money, to get fit. That's marketing again.
And listen, so I will argue the advertiser's side, just so that we get some controversy, because there are advertisers out there who know when they run a 30-second spot on TV that they're going to sell more hamburgers over the weekend, right? They're going to run a promotion. There's a cause and effect.
But
so
they're
a lot
in
of
the shoe business. What the hell do they know about hamburgers? So there's a problem. No, I'm kidding.
So I think a lot of the things we're talking about are where the industry's going to go and has to go. But we're in this sort of this weird world right now where the cause and effect are not necessarily directly tied. And in order for us to get the scale, for an advertiser, a very large advertiser to get the scale or brand to get scale, you're still going to have to use traditional advertising and placements for this period of time.
You know, I think there's an, if you sort of stretch this story out a little bit and you talk about banks, you know, marketing having the purview of, you know, the drugstore that I'm working with, or the marketing having the purview of the bank and the ATM system, there's a very obvious collision here of enterprise infrastructure with what we're trying to do. And this is where the, you know, we say that the CMO and the CIO, it's gone from shotgun wedding to power couple, you know, and we're now in a world where it matters. The enterprise landscape of your marketing infrastructure to the CIO and the technology teams, it matters. That's, you know, we used to, you know, not really want IT in the room, but now
they're mandatory.
Not only can you not avoid it, but you need to embrace it, because they're a key stakeholder in getting the job done. You're not going to talk to that ATM until you're tapped into the IT infrastructure.
So yeah, no. The orchestra seating is different these days, and clearly, you know, from a media marketing perspective, we say that the key elements of a small orchestra are obviously the marketing function, the IT function, the procurement function. You know, everybody's in that conversation now. The thing people have to always be careful of, I think, is great marketers don't let procurement lead that conversation. They let procurement play a role, but not lead violin. But
they need to play a role. So I was with a client here at the show yesterday, and they were talking about the fact that, you know, a campaign manager will be preparing a wonderful big email blast on a Wednesday. The email blast will go out on a Friday. Some clients will open on a Saturday and buy those shoes. Some will open it on a Monday, and the shoes are already sold out. So they want to be able to, and we are able to, dynamically change the content in the email from the thing that is sold out at the weekend because you didn't open it till Monday, so you get an offer for something that's now in stock. That ties into enterprise systems. If you're not really closing the loop back into the supply chain, it's led by marketing, it's about driving sales, so it's led by sales and marketing. But if you're not closing the loop back, you're not serving your client. You're promoting something you don't have in stock.
It's actually interesting, the conversation often between marketing IT obviously centers around the CMO and the CIO, of those two magical figures that make everything happen. But in the end of the day, it is the people underneath them that really make it happen. And we've acknowledged that for some time now. We have a global program called Digital Transformation at Nokia. And basically, we're doing a lot of digital trainings all around the world in the subsidiaries and the regional headquarters and the global teams. And we deliberately invite and train not just the marketing people to become more digital savvy, but we're inviting the IT teams, the comms teams, the care teams, the salespeople, the operator marketing folks to really infuse the entire organization with this kind of digital prowess or this digital baseline understanding. And most of them, I mean, as time goes on, it becomes more and more evident for everybody in the organization, wow, digital is the future, I need to understand this. And obviously the excitement level and the willingness to participate in those trainings and to really absorb that knowledge is obviously amplified year by year.
Well, you know, clearly the outward looking perspective is it's critical for brands today to have continuity in the messages across the platforms. It's more important to have continuity in the understanding internally, because otherwise you've got somebody over here and somebody over there and somebody over here. So hats off to you, because that's probably the basis for how you get to that external messaging, having the continuity across platforms. Let me jump to two things in the spirit of time, because I think we're probably coming close to the end of our session. How are the two concepts that I'm going to throw out there going to impact the evolution? Privacy and that elephant in the room that clearly is there in terms of, you know, our ability to do that round trip, if you will, with the data we have and what the privacy restrictions are. And then the one that'll take far too long, but I just want to throw it out for a jump ball is the measurement of it all. In other words, you know, we don't have that common currency yet. We're striving to get it, but we don't have it yet. You know, Bob, if you would take the first shot at either the privacy or the measurement.
You know, the measurement piece is actually, I think, hits on what John was saying about sort of, we have to, as technology companies, tap into the core stacks of our advertisers. So we have to change and start thinking about our measurements very differently than before. Have we actually sold more hotel rooms? Did we actually get more credit cards? We have to get into, almost tie it into the e-commerce world. So when we start talking about marketing and interaction, how are we tying into the big stacks that, you know, these big brands have made, whether it's IBM, whether it's Oracle, whether it's Adobe, made lots of big bets. Actually, John and I, in my former life, we worked together for Audi, and we actually designed, we actually tapped in through the Adobe system into the car configurator in order to market that car. It was, it's brilliant, but it goes all the way into the customer stack. So the measurement systems have to get to the point where clients will pay a lot more if they know that I've actually booked a dealer appointment. And we've got to get beyond the impression base, the click-through rates, and I think that's where the measurement system needs to go.
I'd agree with that, and it starts from the end result back. Did I get new clients? Did I get more product? Did I get larger basket sizes? And then working down through the kind of market measurements.
Yeah,
and for some reason, we're obsessed with tiny little measurements that start from the bottom up. And as an industry, I think that's very unhealthy. If we connect with the CEO about what actually matters to the outcome and work from that back, it's much easier.
I was just going to add on to what you said, Bob. I've been asked frequently over the years, will marketers pay a premium for that? And the answer is that I always give is, I don't think that would be a premium. I actually think it would be fair value. Because if you could actually reach that person, drive that showroom visit, you're not paying premium. You're paying for what you asked for,
I think there's a shift in the industry right now, because if we go down that path, we now have to re-educate our clients to say, we're actually not going to charge you for this volume of connections. We're only going to charge you for those few, but they're going to cost you a lot more. So your total budget outlay may be the same, but it's on a fewer number of people.
You know, it's the holy grail.
I think measurement, there's no shortage of being able to measure things. I mean, we've, tags on pages, tags on everything. We can measure really infinite amounts of information. It's how do you sort of dismiss or set aside the concept of big data and talk about marketing big data or big data for marketing? And that's pulling out those pieces of the marketing information that are relevant to a customer. That customer may not be known to you yet, but hopefully they will be known to you, and being able to follow them through this anonymous path through to the known path, and deliver value. I mean, that fundamentally, that's the issue around privacy. Is I don't want you shoving stuff in my face if it's not valuable to me.
But your prescription example is a great example. Yeah, you wanted that.
That's
a blessing for you.
That's a very valuable experience, and I'm happy that they have my information, and I'm happy that they use it.
Chris?
Well, first of all, on privacy, we made a deliberate decision to have the privacy team within my digital marketing team to make sure that we start with privacy right from the start at every campaign and every solution. It's not kind of a function that audits the things when everything is already ready, but it's baked in from the start because we take it so seriously as consumers do. In terms of measurement, I think it's absolutely critical. With the explosion of touch points, with the explosion of formats, and the explosion of data, it's so important that we focus on the things that really matter to marketing. What we've done is we've put the consumer in the center and designed a consumer journey, consumer lifecycle, and we designed distinct consumer outcomes. Learn more, buy more, do more, and an overarching tell more. Four distinct phases that are all designed at what the consumer wants out of that in that stage from Nokia. And the single KPI that we've then chosen for each of the phase is one that resonates with that consumer outcome and is one that's very far down the user journey. So it's really almost the conversion point where the person then leaves the online space to fulfill it in the real world, let's say the purchase or the activity that he wants to do with his device. And I think it's so important to have a really, really solid measurement framework in place and also implement that in all aspects of digital marketing, may it be different campaigns, different divisions, but also at all levels, so that really you take everyone on board in the organization to make sure they have these KPIs and also as their personal commitments. And in addition to that, to make it really powerful, is you then use these KPIs obviously with your partners, but also with your agency networks, and make them co-responsible for the achievement of those KPIs. And then you get a real powerful thrust around these KPIs to really focus on
an alignment.
Exactly, it's very, very important. And with that, I think, is one of the key components, I think, to prep any organization for this accelerating, changing future, because if you know what your outcomes are and they're aligned with the consumer outcome, you will know whatever platform will come up, whatever format pops up, you will know very quickly what is truly magical and what's not based on the data that you're getting.
I think that's a great way to bring the conversation to a close. I'd love to keep going, but we've got some time restrictions. So with that, I'd like to thank the four of you for spending the time and sharing the insights, and thank you for listening.
That's good.